Hello, I'm Tom Landon. On behalf of the entire production team here at Blue Ridge Public Television, I'd like to welcome you to Song of the Mountains, From the Cutting Room Floor, and More. As we produced this series, we found that there were some things that didn't quite fit into our regular episodes, but we thought you might appreciate a look at the backstage footage, never-seen performances, and a few stories from our archives that help illuminate just how important mountain music is to our region. Our first segment includes a look behind the scenes at the process of recording Song of the Mountains and a musical performance by Gerald Anderson and his band recorded during our dress rehearsal. Enjoy.
Yes, it should be.
Hopefully, the bluegrass music isn't as dirty as the country music we just did.
I think they're running cables for the power now. Then we'll get the EIC and start pulling all the cables out, run where we need to run, get everything set up. But we have to get power first. If we're out 5 minutes, you can take it easy. But no more than that. Then it's...
Well, I think it's a great event, and I think that if everything goes smoothly, I won't have to fire you.
That's very nice for. Ready for? And for dissolve. And gently widen out a little bit for. Keep panning. Nice and gentle. Ready to.
Up in the control room, see that monitor, see the cameras change, to hear just rapid fire directions from the producer in terms of what she was directing those cameras to do. It was exhilarating.
It was nice to know that we could stop and start if we made mistakes. So that put us at ease, and everybody at WBRA was just great to work with.
I think it was very interesting to see how all of this is filmed and what goes on behind the scenes.
Great audience, great time. It's a blast.
It was exciting. I mean, it was exhilarating, truly.
Welcome to the Lincoln. Enjoy the show.
It's called the Sugarfoot Rag.
Thank you.
You know, seeing the gorgeous Lincoln Theater on television is great, but actually being there is even better. We'd like to share the story of the Lincoln and its amazing transformation from a place that was ready for the wrecking ball to a beautiful showplace. We'd also like to share some backstage interviews and performances that demonstrate the love these musicians have for each other and the music they share.
The Lincoln Theater was built in 1929 by a man named Charles Lincoln, who was a native of Marion. He owned the local furniture factory. He wanted to build not just a theater for his hometown, but an actual show place.
He traveled a lot, particularly in the Northeast, and he saw a theater in New York that, when he came back from that visit, decided that that's what this theater needed to look like. And so he contracted with a scenic design studio in New York to provide the decoration for the theater.
This theater, being constructed in 1928, 1929, was a Mayan, I guess you would say, a recreation of a Mayan temple. And to me, that was incredibly fun because it actually brought a part of the world into a region of the United States that the people here were probably not very familiar with that culture. And I think that's absolutely fascinating. The part of the theater that I think was most important actually was the stage area, because you had the background of the, as you would say, savagery. In those days they would term that. While we know the Mayan culture is very sophisticated these days, in 1929 it was considered almost a barbaric culture. And then you had the front stage area, which was the looking forward to the future. And so this whole place was built around really the concept of from savagery to barbarism through literacy. And the main screen area was the tool of literacy of the time, if you think about it, because movie theaters were not common in this area, and that was a very important tool to teach people how, you know, about the world itself.
When the theater opened in 1929, it was a cinema. And you have to remember that that was a new thing. It was referred to in the historical accounts that I have read from that period as a talking picture palace. Part of that, of course, had to do with the very ornate design that you see here. And part of it was just that was a new medium. Many people saw their first movie here.
I attended this theater as a pre-teenager and as a teenager and as a high school student here, and seeing a lot of the old westerns and a lot of the old serials that we had on Saturdays and the old cartoons that you don't see much anymore, the Donald Duck and Mickey Mouse cartoons. We had the double features on Saturday, and we could attend the theater here for a dime. You could stay all afternoon and just get home before dark.
If you look around the theater, you will see mythical creatures, animals, a motif that was really a part of the Art Deco movement at that time, you know, that things were very ornate, very elaborate. You will also see that there is another kind of art here that is quite different from the Mayan motif. There are six large mural paintings. These murals were painted by a Smith County woman named Lola Poston. They reflect historical paintings that were popular, well-known at that time. We have Daniel Boone here, we have Columbus, we have Robert E. Lee, we have Cornwallis. In addition to those two, there are also two murals which are quite specific to the region. One celebrates the cattle industry within Smith County, and the other looks at the industrial contributions within Smith County. There's a mill and water power. But these murals are quite fabulous, to be honest.
The theater restoration is really our community's heart. I mean, the incredible incarnate painting of the Mayan symbols and the mask and so forth was done by 50, 60 volunteers from our community that never painted anything like that in their entire life. And as we were building the theater, we could not afford professional artistic painters to do this renovation of all this fine Mayan art. And it was really done by volunteers, and it's incredible to look at it. And it's probably the most powerful part of the story is to see a community come together in any part of the world and believe in itself and rise have a rise in its self-esteem.
Enjoy the show.
Thank you.
This thing used to be really run down. They letting it go, but they have spent over $2 million to restore it. And it is absolutely one of the most beautiful theaters I've played in anywhere. And it's the acoustics are great. It's a venue that people need to come and see. Just to walk through if there's no shows going on, just to see how pretty it really is.
My dad's band played here several years before they started renovating it. It kind of had a hole in the ceiling and it was kind of run down. And since they pretty much just redid everything, it's just been very impressive. They've had a lot of good people here. And I just think it's a great place to shoot it because it's so nice and just a state-of-the-art facility. One of the nicest places that I personally have ever had the chance to perform.
I think what the Lincoln represents is that we were able to not depend on somebody externally to come and help us, but that we as a community could help ourselves, and that by believing and trusting and working together, we could create almost anything we wanted to create. Savior, call my name.
Southwest Virginia is just so full of music tradition from Bristol all the way up, and that's where I grew up, you know. I grew up in Patrick County, Virginia, which is a lot of musicians came from that area and just across the line in North Carolina. And just seems like Western Virginia, Western North Carolina, East Tennessee, and East Kentucky is where a big part of the musicians on the road today come from.
Is just it's music from the soul, it's music from the heart, and it's music for everybody because it relates to everybody. It's about real people and real people's lives.
just it's playing from your heart. You know, it's just packed with so much emotion, and it's just raw music. It's just music in its rawest form. So I guess that's what really just kind of pulls me to it.
I think getting out to the younger crowd is important too, you know. So the big thing to me would be them being able to see it as well as hear it. I think turns them on to it.
I've been in gospel and country and pop, and this is by far the hardest music to reach perfection in that I've ever experienced. It's just, there's an expected range in this genre that they don't expect in any other kind of music. In any other kind of music, you can, people satisfied with whatever range you have. But in this genre, you need to at least be able to reach more than a whole octave, below or above what you normally sing. It's a great challenge.
A lot of times you tell people you play bluegrass, they think Deliverance and you play banjo, and of course that was like a terrible stereotype for all of our kind of music, especially if you're a banjo player, which I'm not, of course, but anyway, that movie really, I guess it brought a lot of awareness, but in a lot of ways it probably hurt. But I think the Old Brother movie was just the opposite. I think that was really a classy movie, and I don't think it made fun of the musicians. And I think the people that were doing that movie sort of respected the music. Obviously they did. I think it was a great thing.
Here recently, I think the Old Brother Where Art Thou movie kind of spawned a new interest in it. And all through these phases that we've been through over the years, we gain new fans from it. We may not keep them all forever, but we gain another fan base. And it takes phenomenons like those that I mentioned to kind of keep the music going and keep us a fan base, because the people that grew up with Flat and Scruggs and Bill Monroe, a lot of those folks aren't around anymore. So we're trying to develop an audience for 20 years from now. So I think if we keep these little things happening, and it'll continue to grow.
My dad got me this old-time banjo, which most people in the music, they use it for claw hammer. And this is a bluegrass banjo because it's got the resonator, but an old-time banjo, you don't have the picks, and you play a claw hammer style. So I got to listening to it, and I said, well, I want to do it with them picks. And so I got the picks out and started taking lessons. What I'm going to do is show you a difference in the two styles. In a claw hammer style, you have an old-time fiddle which plays the melody, and the banjo will do like a hit and a strum, like a rhythm. So it'll be like... That's a claw hammer style. Now in the bluegrass style, what you've got is these little picks. They're called finger picks. You got a thumb pick, finger pick, which goes on the first finger, and then another finger pick, which goes on the second finger. And Earl Scruggs made this style famous, called the three fingers roll and pattern style, kind of something like this. So you can hear a big difference. This right here is kind of playing like a melody. And in old time, it's playing like a rhythm behind the fiddle. So that's kind of the difference in the two banjo styles.
My name is Miss Montana Young.
Well, I went to Galax and
the Fiddler's Convention, and I saw a girl about my age now, except she's bigger now, and she was playing the fiddle and dancing and singing, and it really inspired me, and I was like, I want to learn fiddle. They got me lessons, and that's what got me started. Well, classical, it's more of learning it off of sheet music, and it seems so much proper. But bluegrass is fun for me, and I don't know, it's just got a different sound, and it's cool. I like it because it's fun, and it's nice to listen to, and I get to meet a lot of people through it. Well, we played at New York, and we were supposed to play at the Lincoln Center, but something went wrong, and I've played at Fiddler's Conventions a lot. I've played at the Rex Theater. This is big to me.
What I grew up on, and it's, to me, it's one of the most real forms of music there is. I mean, what you see is what you get. There's no effects, no ways to beef it up. You know, we play what you hear.
I feel very proud to be from this part of the country, and I feel that our Appalachian culture has a lot to offer, and it's fun to be a part of it. I'm very proud that I was raised here, and I'm very proud to tell people and let people know where I'm from, and that this is a really good place to grow up and live your life.
One of the reasons that bluegrass and traditional music continue to thrive is that it's not just the music of old folks. Like the finger-picking patterns and lyrics that are handed down from generation to generation, the music itself is constantly in a state of revival and renewal, made possible in part by folks who run programs like the Traditional Music Program at Mount Rogers School in Grayson County and the East Tennessee State University Bluegrass Pride Band. The school that started in this four-room building has now started a unique music program. The Mount Rogers School is home to the Albert Hash Memorial Band.
The Albert Hash Memorial Band was named after a fiddle maker from this area who's very well known, who died in 1983, named Albert Hash. And he and his daughter Audrey and my husband Thornton Spencer and myself helped start this band back about 1982 here at the school. And it's been going ever since, more or less, keeping the old time music alive. Audrey was the band director for many years here. And then after she quit doing it, I started doing it all the time.
There are even descendants of the original band. Jacob Hamm, who plays fiddle in the Mount Rogers School Band, is related to Audrey Hamm, who helped to get the Albert Hash Memorial Band started.
She married with my great uncle, my grandpa's brother, and she married him. So, and the fiddle I play, she made it. Audrey did.
For many of the students in the band, their interest in old-time music came from their families.
I've just been around it since I've been a baby. I think if kids heard it, they probably like it better. A lot of them just haven't been around it, and some of them, as when they hear it more, they start liking it. Both of my parents played, and I've been around it all my life, and I really like it. So I started playing when I was about 8, and just really like it a lot.
Emily also does her part to foster her students' love for old-time music.
Emily, her and her husband, and them, they got their own band, and she pretty well can play about anything that she picks up, and she's real patient with you. I mean, she's always been patient, never tried to hurry you or nothing. She lets you work at your own pace, and if you're playing something you don't like it, you go pick up and change and play something else, and whatever. And she just works with you, basically. And her son and stuff, we go out there at their house a lot of times on the weekends and just play out there. So. And she just lets us come in, a bunch of people sitting in her living room sometimes, and we just go in and play.
Many of the Mount Rogers students aren't distracted by sports, so there's plenty of time for music.
This is basically our main thing, so where everybody else is playing football or basketball or something, they're more into that, and music's just more or less what they listen to instead of do.
The nature of Mount Rogers' small school and community seems perfect for this unusual school band.
This community's so small, we just a little different. I think it's neat that we have a string band because this area plays this kind of music, and our school's actually kind of carrying on the tradition. It's a really small school, and then where we're allowed to play the string music, it makes it more, even more unique than a lot of the other schools that have the marching band and things. So I think it's pretty neat that we can have a string band instead of a marching band.
Emily would like to see the idea behind this program spread.
I also think it's something that would work well in other schools too, because it's something the kids seem to relate to. It's something they can do together and with other people. And, you know, throughout a large area, and something, it's kind of a lifetime skill too.
Martha has already started teaching old-time music to other kids.
I think it's good that they're starting a lot of more programs to teach younger kids because it helps carry on the tradition of the area with the music. So I'm glad to be helping with that.
But the most important thing is always the music.
Area here is where it's the Nashville of old-time music, this region is, you know, so it's really appropriate that this program be here because, like I said, it's the world's capital, as it says outside of Galax, of old-time music.
I love the music. I grew up listening to it. Some of my family plays bluegrass from South Georgia, and there's not a whole lot of bluegrass down there, so had to come up here to find it.
One, two, three.
We offer a variety of courses, some of them strictly oriented toward performing. We offer lessons in each of the bluegrass instruments, guitar, mandolin, banjo, fiddle, bass, dobro. We also offer old-time styles on the banjo and the fiddle. And then we have performing bands. This semester we have 9 different bands who are performing. And some of them are in the early stages of learning, some of them are extremely performing at a very high level, just pretty close to professional level, actually. And in addition, we have courses like songwriting, the roots of bluegrass, music, contemporary, survey of contemporary bluegrass, harmony, singing. We have a bluegrass seminar that acquaints the students with a variety of topics that relate to music and to musicianship and making the most of your association with music. So there's a lot for students to sink their teeth into.
I like how the bluegrass and country music program takes something that's so unique from Appalachia and this region that we have around here, and the art form that comes from the hills and the mountains and probably from people's grandfathers and grandmothers and whatnot, and it takes it and makes it cool. It makes it, you can study it in a very serious way, and we also get to spread it a lot of places. Like, for instance, we went to Japan a few years ago and got to do it there, and also in Brussels, Belgium this last Christmas. We have some of the best direction in the country as far as I'm concerned. Jack Tottle, who is the director and founder of the program, he has performed with many, many musicians, including Bela Fleck and Pat Enright and Mark Schatz, and he actually gave them all their first jobs with the Tasty Licks back in the 70s. And Raymond McLean, he's toured 62 countries of the world, played on the Grand Ole Opry over 1,000 times, so I think that you could learn a lot from people who have done such things like that.
When students come, I think they have a variety of ideas about what they can learn here and about what can be accomplished. And I think most all of them are right on the money. I hope that we help students who not only who want to be professional entertainers, not only students who already have a lot of experience and just want to have more experience, but I hope we help the beginning students as well, the intermediate students. I hope that we help not only people that want to make music their career, but people that just want music to be an important part of their lives.
It's really amazing to be under the instruction of somebody like Raymond, because, and I think a lot of people take it for granted, but he's been there, done that, and I think a lot of people forget that, but it's really great to be able to converse with somebody about, you know, what they've already done it, you know what I mean? He's done it before, and so to be able to talk to him about it, you're really getting something done, you know what I mean?
I can honestly tell you that I've been exceedingly pleased that I came, because, I mean, I have, like, one of the best jobs in the whole world. I get to work with these talented, enthusiastic, dedicated young people who are willing to work so very hard at something that I love. What could be better?
Well, I mean, I came here for a learning experience, and that's definitely what it is, you know. We get to perform a lot with a coach who helps us as a band, you know, figure out how to be a better band and how to promote ourselves, and so it's just experience in the music business and the music world. It's a really great experience, you know, because, and I feel really lucky because this is the only place where you can get something like that. So it's just great, you know. Every day I'm like, wow, this is really awesome that I get to be going to college down here in Tennessee and playing bluegrass music all the time whenever I want.
It's a good vent. I don't know. I don't even know if I would have even went to college if it hadn't been for the bluegrass music program. I mean, it. I guess in some ways it's like being in athletics or something. It gives you something else to shoot for, you know. Definitely, school's not my most favorite thing, which it's not very many people's. But with the opportunity to be able to play music as well, it kind of, you know, it evens out and it gives you something to look forward to.
I think my goal in being here is to be able to get the exposure that I think we're getting right now. And having been here for a year and kind of, you know, got used to everything last year, and this year it's going to be easier to tackle that, you know, be able to get out and get the exposure and be immersed in Southern Appalachia with all the music and all the people. So we have, you know, all these people around here who are musicians, and then there's all these festivals, you know, every weekend you could be busy at a festival, so I think that's the idea.
Music, not only bluegrass, but just music's always going to play a really large role in my life. I'd like to be a weekend musician, you know, if I could play around local festivals, if I could, but more for fun and friendship. That's the most important thing about this whole experience, is just realize just how many friends you make just through music. It's just a common language. J.P. Mathis, the banjo player, is just a super nice guy, and he has so much positive energy, and Daniel Boner's a great singer, and everyone else, they're just great musicians, and they're, you know, becoming greater and greater friends, so it's been a wonderful experience.
My plan is, I had lots of goals before I came here, and now my plan is to get the most out of it that I can, and that's it, just to play in time and in tune, and to, you know, experience this, because there's so much more here than I anticipated.
Oh, I definitely think that that younger people are learning about bluegrass, not just around here and in the mountains, but also all over the country and all over the world. And it's only thanks to organizations like the EDKSU Bluegrass Program and so many of the performers that take their time out to share it with people all around the world.
And I just think it's awesome that they see the benefit in studying formally something that's always been learned informally down through the years.
we seem to be getting more and more students playing at a high level, and that means we can have more bands that go out and perform in public and represent the university as well as the music.
Well, the students obviously are our greatest asset, our greatest resource, our greatest asset, the best thing we have. But I can only say with enormous gratitude that we have the support of East Tennessee State University. They found new accommodations for us, offices and classrooms, at a time when such things are scarce. They've helped us grow when it wasn't easy to do so.
Things are going extremely well right now, and we have every reason to think that it's just going to get better and better as we have more and more students from all sorts of different backgrounds, and as our students go out into the music world and do wonderful things that reflects well on the university and also on bluegrass music itself.
It's not just the songs that are from the mountains. Many of the musicians you see on the series are playing instruments that are actually made in the mountains, from wood harvested with care and carefully constructed in workshops tucked away in the hills. One of the best known local luthiers is Wayne Henderson, and people come from all over the world to visit his shop and buy the instruments he makes with care and attention to detail. A few years back, we visited Wayne's shop and thought you might like to see what we found.
And it's really important to appreciate the fact that these people, they don't go out in the stores and buy their instruments. They make their instruments. It's not just fiberglass and stainless steel. It's wood, and they make it with their own hands. It's just such a vast operation that people really need to see that. It takes time and effort, and it's not just machines making it sound that way. It's their talent.
Working with Wayne was, I really consider myself lucky to have gotten to do that, because a lot of people had asked him about doing that, and I had known Wayne when I was real little. I was like in grade school and he was in high school, and so I sort of knew who he was, and when I got out of college I didn't really have a job, so I went down and started doing a little sanding for him and cleaning up the shop, and gradually started repairing instruments, and eventually started making instruments. I made a few guitars, and then I really got started making mandolins in the 80s pretty much. That's been more of my main thing has been mandolins, and I've made 100 and the one I just finished 109 and 110. So I've made quite a few mandolins, and I was just lucky enough to get to hang out with him, learn how to make them, and learn how to play them, and I got to go do a lot of really neat things because of that.
In this corner of Grayson County, music is made from scratch. Wayne Henderson has been playing music for nearly 50 years and making instruments for almost as long.
I've been making instruments of one form or another since I was, like 10 or 11 years old. And I've been making these guitars that have a serial number. The first one I made that's still together, my mother still has, was made in 1964. And had a number one stamped in it. And that was the first one ever made, and I've made since then. Of course, you can see I just have a small shop and work on just one or two guitars at a time. And sometimes have more than that going, but I've made like 265 guitars and of various shapes and kinds of wood and things. And I've made about 77 mandolins and 15 banjos and two fiddles and one dobro. And make a few other instruments like that, mostly guitars.
Several of the guitars Wayne has made now have very famous homes.
I've made instruments for Doc Watson, who's a hero of mine, somebody that I've listened to for years and learned music from, and probably my favorite player of anybody. And I've made one for Norman Blake, who's another, pretty famous folk music, especially since this Oh Brother thing came out. He did a tune on that soundtrack. And also, speaking of that bunch, too, I made one for Gillian Welch, too. You know, she did a lot of the music on that soundtrack. And Peter Rowan, who's a pretty famous bluegrass musician, I made one for him. And the one people have heard of the most, Eric Clapton, did ask for one, but, you know, he don't come around and get after me about it like you have to get me to do something. And I reckon he still wants one. I may eventually get around to doing it sometime. But he did ask for one.
Creating these guitars is more than just a craft. It's also an art.
This process right here is called shaving the braces or voicing them. And what that does is when you... This top has a lot to do with the sound, is the vibrations of the top. And as you trim these braces and make them weaker right here in the middle, that lets them vibrate more when the string vibrates the top after the guitar is finished. And you can adjust the tone by doing that.
Making a guitar is a very involved process that begins with finding the right kind of wood.
We go out in the, sometimes just out in the mountain up here, sometimes in White Top or usually in West Virginia, and find the Appalachian red spruce. You can tell by the bark it has on it. It looks a little bit like a wild cherry tree, actually, the bark does. And just cut it out into logs, and then you split it into pieces like wedges like this. Then you take this big old resaw here, which is a big thing you lay right up here, and you can saw thin slices off so you get the spruce tops like that. And so that's a pretty interesting, you know, where you just go out in the woods and find wood that's proper for a guitar. Then take this side bender thing. I have a pot here that take a straight side, and you cook it like you was boiling your beans for lunch or something, and put it right here until it gets hot for about 15-20 minutes, and then put it in this homemade contraption here that's made out of plywood, and there's three light bulbs on the inside of it. And you clamp it in here, it clamps down, and this thing screws down in the middle, and it holds it in the shape of a half of a guitar, and it stays in there for about 35-40 minutes, and you pull this out like that, and it makes a guitar side. And then after you get this side bent, you glue it into shapes of, you know, like this, glue the blocks, these head blocks in, and the kerfing, this kerfing stuff's real important, all these little saw cuts in it, so it holds the whole body of a guitar together with all these little saw cuts, so it'll bend, and then makes a little more surface for the back and sides and top to be glued together. Otherwise, you know, when you routed for the bindings, it would fall apart. And then you go over here, and the next thing I'd do would take like this side, and after you get it, form, you know, we've already got a little ahead of ourselves here. It goes in this big form here until you get the back, you know, get this glued down on here, and then when you get this all glued down, it, you know, becomes you know, the body sort of in this form, and this then you route it with a little router and cut out for bindings. And this is called a little herringbone trim. Those things are made out of little blocks of wood, and they come usually from Germany. I used to, when I first started making them, I would make that stuff, and it would take me days, but now you can buy a piece of strip of that for $5, and it used to take me probably almost a week to put in so many thousand of those little pieces, you know, to make that pattern. And some of them are a little fancier that have a, you know, the abalone trim around here. You know, I'll show you in a little bit how we saw a piece. It comes from a shell like this, and then it's cut up into little strips and pieces, and it's put in, inlaid in just like the wood trim was in the other body. And it has these little wood black and white stripes around the edge that are made out of wood. And also other inlays are made out of abalone shells that are sawed with a little jeweler saw, and I'll demonstrate that a little bit later. And set in the wood. This is a piece of ebony the fingerboards are made out of. Grows in Africa and Gabon, part of country in Africa, and it grows that black. It doesn't have any stain or color or anything on it, and it's real dense, heavy wood, and it wears. You know, it'll last for years without wearing out. And then when it gets in this shape, the next thing I gotta do is make a neck for it. And I have like a, excuse me for wobbling around here so much, but take a, this is mahogany, take a 4x4 to start with, and you bandsaw the shape out here and cut the dovetail joint so it fits in this slot here. Real, it's all got to be real precision fit, you know, so it'll stay. Put a fingerboard on there. You can sort of see how that'll eventually be a guitar neck. And that'll, you know, that's pretty much the parts and pieces, the major ones. And you saw some of the braces on the inside, how they get trimmed and voiced. And all that stuff is for sound. Then when you get a guitar, you can hear the tone ringing. I hope that picks up on your microphones and things. And a good guitar, if you get Herb to take that lighter and hold it up over and show the how it'll blow out a light, you know. But that's a pretty interesting thing to do. You can hear the tone. This guitar is made of Brazilian rosewood, if you can see that pattern in the sides. And that wood is extremely rare and hard to come by. And I wish there was lots of it, but it's the only way you get it is where you find some that's been in somebody's wood pile for years, and Brazil doesn't export that kind of wood anymore. It's some sort of an endangered species, and lots of the old instruments were made out of it. And that's what I like to do, is duplicate the old stuff as close as I can. And because it's my favorite instruments, the old Martins made back in the 30s and everything are, to me, the best ones that were ever made. And if you can get the material, you can come pretty close to duplicating them now, but it's so hard to find the materials, you know. The spruce I was talking about earlier is the same spruce they used. And of course, like Brazilian rosewood like this, gets ever more harder to find as time goes on. But there's still, you find a piece once in a while. For the inlays and the fingerboards and things, sometimes we use this little jeweler saw, which is a tiny blade, and just mark on a piece of abalone shell here, like the shape of an inlay. Have this little vise. My brother, Max, who's my older brother, he's a machinist who makes some of these machines I have. And this is sort of a thing that he made. I can press with my foot and hold it, and that way I can saw and hold it at the same time.
While Wayne stays pretty busy making new guitars, his friend Herb repairs old and damaged instruments.
We try to limit our repair work to Gibsons and Martins and good guitars. Somebody said, do you work on any Henderson guitars? And I said, no, they don't really need any work. They maybe a little tweaking and adjusting occasionally, but they're made really well. And the instruments that Wayne makes for people they're mostly musicians, and they know how to take care of their instruments.
And they certainly sound great.
It was what I grew up listening to, and at an early age I started playing it because of exposure from my grandfathers. Both one played and the other one loved music, so I got a lot of exposure to the music.
Well, I had a cousin that played. My family's always listened to bluegrass music, and we'd get together, you know, family get-togethers and stuff, and he always was playing the guitar, and I just kind of become fascinated with it.
Anyone who follows this music knows the importance of family to its success. The Stanleys and the Carters are two of the best known, but there are many, many more. For decades, the McPeaks have been sharing their tight harmony and pick and prowess with audiences. And after a recent debilitating illness, Larry McPeak rejoined his brothers to appear together once again on Song of the Mountains.
Over on rhythm guitar, he does all the harmony parts, and he's the youngest one of the group. He's only 61. 61. Okay, but he hails from Withfield, Virginia. That's little brother Mike McPeak, if you give him a hand. Back on the five-string banjo, one of the finest lead singers I've ever graced the stage with. I'm not saying that just because he's going to give me a ride home after a while, but but he is. He's one of the finest. This is my brother Dewey McPeak on banjo. And y'all know me from the previous wreck that was out here, the VW Boys. My name's Larry McPeak, and we're the McPeak Brothers, and we're glad to be here tonight. We'll call Dewey around to do you a real pretty slow song. It goes like this.
Band started about 1963 with my brother Dewey and my older brother Udale, and I was still in high school, and we would play local events, churches, picnics. Udale went and joined Red Smiley on WDBJ in Roanoke and played with him for a long time. And so me and Dewey, we was doing a duet act at the time. And about 1967, we asked our younger brother, Mike, if he'd like to come and play guitar with us. Oh, boy, was he mad. He didn't like bluegrass at all. My goodness. Almost had to twist his arm for him to come and play. But after he got into playing and seeing what we were wanting to do, we were drawn to the harmonies of... we would listen to people like the Browns, the Wilburn Brothers, the Leuven Brothers, Monroe Brothers, all those guys that sang really good harmony, and that's what we were drawn to. And after he figured out what we wanted, then he fell right in and just made the trio what it is today.
Sometimes we don't always see eye to eye. Someone gets hurt because of their pride.
Songwriting to me is a way of a release. I'll have an idea in my head and it'll worry me. And I have to just stop mostly whatever I'm doing and sit down and figure out what this song is trying to tell me. And it's given me a lot of enjoyment. It's taken a lot of stress from me. Back when I was really sick, with my liver problems before I got my transplant, seemed like the weight of the world would be on you. And I could take my guitar and sit down and do a song, and it's just like everything just lifted. And I get so much enjoyment out of writing tunes, but the biggest thrill I get is when someone asks me if they could record one of my songs. And to me, that's the greatest compliment anybody could ever pay me. And it doesn't have to be a major name band. If someone thinks my material is good enough for them, that's just such a joy in my heart that I just glow with it.
Now Mama was taken just 3 days ago, just out of the blue, God called her home. To be in a portrait he'll hang on his wall, with a caption that reads, "The world's greatest mom."
It was written about a friend of ours, and he was telling me about a friend of his, telling this story that his mother had died and he hadn't gone to any of the family reunions ever because Uncle So-and-so was there, Aunt So-and-so, and they didn't get along. And his mother told him, said, "You need to go." Said, "You know, you don't know who may not be there next year." So he didn't go, and sometime they had a reunion on Sunday, and then one day during that week, I don't know if it was 3 days or not, I just put that in, but she died. His mother died, and they got the pictures back in a week or so, and he picked up the one with all the people in it, and he said, "This is the last one that I will never be in." So Mama's not here, there'll never be another group picture like this, and this is the last family portrait that I'll never be in. So I came home and wrote a tune about it. It's a truthful music. And it's a music that's easy to understand. All you have to do is just listen to the words and the melody. You don't have to figure out what's in the background. Everything is up front.
I see pride is standing where I should have been, like the last family portrait that I wasn't in the last family portrait that I wasn't in.
Before we leave you, we've got one more treat to share. During our first night of taping for Song of the Mountains, the audience was treated to a performance by the VW Boys, a band that includes Tim White, the MC and host of our series. Now, the VW Boys have a unique appeal with their down-home, corny humor, and people in these parts just can't get enough of them. Due to time constraints, most of their jokes hit the cutting room floor, but we've scooped them back up and we'll end the show with them. I hope you've enjoyed this look behind the scenes at Song of the Mountains. For all of us at Blue Ridge Public Television and the Lincoln Theater, I'm Tom Landon saying so long.
Here we go, boys. that's real entertainment right there, folks.
For just a little while, we're going to play some music here on Song of the Mountains at the beautiful Lincoln Theater and entertain you for our little part of the show here. And we're going to play some songs you probably heard before, maybe some you haven't heard before.
Hey, you promised me that before it started I could do some more magic on this show.
Wait a minute. This is a short set. We've got to play a little bit of music. We'll let you do a little more magic because you know what time it is.
Who, me?
No time skip. Yeah, you.
No, I ain't got a watch. No, I had one, but it don't work no more. It was 32 karat gold, total electric, anti-magnetic, self-winding, shock-resistant, waterproof, rust-proof, and dust-proof.
Good. What happened to it?
Caught on fire. Honey, let me be your soggy dog. Let me be your soggy dog. I won't be your man at all. Honey, let me be your soggy dog. Let me be your soggy dog. Let me be your soggy dog. I won't be your man at all. Honey, let me be your soggy dog. Let me be your soggy dog, or I won't be your man at all. Honey, let me be your soggy dog.
I pulled the trigger and the gun let go. The shot fell over the link at the gate.
Honey, let me be your soggy dog. Let me be your soggy dog, I won't be your man at all. Honey, let me be your soggy dog, yeah. Let me be your soggy hog, I won't be your hog at all. Honey, let me be your soggy dog.
Don't get up. I'll get up if you want to.
Yeah.
Let me introduce the guys to you real quick. Fellow right over here, you've probably seen him all through the Tri-Cities region and the birthplace of country music out here. round about he's a fine musician, fine magician. Nobody he taught me everything I know about magic. And he's got a magic store in Bristol, Tennessee. He does a lot of good work, and we're going to show his singing off here in just a little while. He's originally from Saltville, Virginia. I'm telling about
well, you better watch what Davey's doing over here, Bubs.
Shoot! What are you doing?
Huh?
Good sakes.
Why are you drinking the Windex?
I have to. It's medicine.
Windex is medicine?
Yep. Oh, yeah.
Medicine for what?
Oh, I remember. I have a strong tendency to take all my clothes off and run around. This keeps me from streaking.
I believe I'd finish that bottle off. We want that happening over here. Now, he now resides in Bristol, Tennessee, Virginia, right smack dab in the middle of the birthplace of country music region. If you'd put your hands together, it makes him feel real good. Mr. Dave Vaught, right there.
Thank you very much, folks. And the gentleman on the other end doing most all the talking had this crazy idea to put this group together. He's no stranger to these parts at all. He's a great entertainer. And a matter of fact, he's one of the founders of the Birthplace of Country Music Alliance out of Bristol, Virginia, Tennessee. Most of you seen that big mural painted on the side of that three-story building down there, dedicated to Birthplace of Country Music. You guys seen that? Well, that's the man that painted the mural right there. That's him.
Thank you.
Yeah. Well, now I know that sounds like a lot, but Larry and I had to put all the numbers on the side of the building for him to go by, so that took a lot there, see. And ladies and gentlemen, he is the best banjo player in this band. Mr. Tim White from Blountville, Tennessee.
Thank you very much. Don't get up. Don't get up. Thank you.
It didn't take us too long to figure out everybody around here likes money tricks. And they said if I'd get with the BW boys, I'd be in big money. That ain't what I meant. But it's all right. I made this up myself. Be nice to me. This is the first time on national TV that I'm going to do this. I'm going to place it right there. I'll make it vanish from that side of the box. And it's that simple. It's gone. They missed it on this side. You want to? I'll show you that side. It's not over there. I know. See, you think you see it going back and forth. That's part of the illusion. It doesn't go back and forth at all. Won't you go home and tell your mama she wants you? I'll prove it to you. I'll check. Nope. Gone. I have to prove everything to you, don't I? It's right over here in your pocket where it belongs, there, see? Thank you very much. You know, we've had the privilege of doing two full seasons at Dollywood Amusement Park, and every show we did down there, like, we got a request for this next song we're going to do for you. It's a little duet originally recorded by the Carter family, but made popular by Lester Flatt and Earl Scruggs. We didn't know it. Larry and I got together last night and said, let's try it out tonight.
Hey,
see what it sounds like.
Wait a minute.
What? I'm trying to talk to these folks.
I heard what you said.
What?
You said a duet.
Yeah.
Dave, a duet is two people singing the song. And there's three of us on stage here at the Lincoln Theater tonight. And I know these folks will back me up when I say this, David. When there's three people on stage, we should be singing a quartet.
No.
Don't tell him.
So what am I going to do while you and Larry sing this duet of yours?
I'll bet you the next act would appreciate if you get the rest of your group together and clean this mess up here.
Doug, the camera guy, is going to do that after the show, aren't
you, Doug? Yeah, well, you hold your breath. Wait a minute. I just heard last night through a reliable source you like jigsaw puzzles.
I love jigsaw puzzles. I put them together as a hobby.
Well, that's cool. I'll tell you what I'm going to do. I don't happen to have one with me tonight, but if you and Larry have picked something for these nice folks out here today.
I just finished up a big jigsaw puzzle, Dave. I did.
Did you?
Yeah.
Good.
Is it 300?
I'm going to try to tell you. I don't have one, but if you and Larry have picked something for these nice folks here at the Lincoln...
What is tonight? Tonight is Saturday? Saturday? I finished that puzzle Tuesday night after 3 weeks, Dave. 3 weeks of hard work. I got that puzzle finished Tuesday night.
3 weeks on a jigsaw.
Well, you laugh if you want to.
I'm going to.
Folks, 3 weeks ain't bad, because right on the side of the box, it said 3 to 5 years.
Don't dare explain it to him. Well, as I was trying to say, if you'll pick something for these nice folks, I'll make you a jigsaw puzzle. It won't take me just a second. Give it to him. Tell him put that back together. I bet that'd take him at least 3 weeks.
You ain't right, dude.
Enough to get through this song.
I hope so.
I sell the morning paper, sir, my name is Jimmy Brown. Everybody knows that I'm the newsboy of the town. You can hear me yelling Morning Star when I go along the street. I got no hat upon my head, no shoes upon my feet. I sell the morning paper, sir, my name is Jimmy Brown. Everybody knows that I'm the newsboy of the town.
Thank you!
Like you, Dave.
I'll play it again. You liked it so much.
Hey, Dave, I finished that puzzle you made for me.
I sell the morning paper, sir. My name is Timmy White. Everybody knows that we are here to pick tonight.
We got a young man out here. Thank you. We appreciate that. We appreciate that. Thank you very much. And I tell you what, we've saved the best of our show to last.
Absolutely.
We're going to bring him out here now.
I better drink some more of this.
We've got a young man. Actually, he was the first recipient of the Benny Sims Scholarship at East Tennessee State University several years ago in memory of the great Benny Sims, who played the fiddle with Lester Flatt and Earl Scruggs on the original Foggy Mountain Breakdown. We started that scholarship when Benny was still living. He got to see the scholarship started in his name, and it goes on today at ETSU. And this young man was the first recipient. He's a funny guy. He likes to play the clawhammer banjo, and we're going to prove it to you right now. Welcome, Mr. Robbie Spencer from Bluff City, Tennessee.
All right. Where are these marks at? I only see feathers. All right. Have I hit my mark now?
Are you good?
What do you want me to do first? Tell a fairy tale?
Yeah.
Yeah, go ahead.
Okay, once upon a time there was two little babies in a nursery, and there was a little boy and a little girl. And they got to talking to each other one day, and the little girl looked over at the little boy and said, "Tell me, are you a little boy or a little girl?" And the little boy said, I'll have you know I'm 100% little boy. And the little girl says, I don't believe you. So the little boy said, well, I'll tell you what, just as soon as that nurse leaves the room, I'll show you that I'm a little boy. And about that time, the nurse left the room. And here the little boy goes and kicks all of his covers off and throws both legs over the side of the crib and points down and says, now see here, I got blue booties on. Do I have time to tell the world's shortest fairy tale?
Oh, yeah.
Go ahead.
Once upon a time, this boy asked this girl to marry him. She said no. He lived happily ever after. Let's sing a green, green grass at home.
Oh, that's one of my favorites.
Now, do I have to move or do I stay where I am?
Stay that way and point your banjo this way.
All right. The old hometown looks the same as I step down from the train. There to meet me was my mama and my papa. Smiling sweetly, it's good to touch the green, green grass at home. The old hometown looks upside down, 'cause I'm laying on the ground. There's the old freight train that I just fell off of. Down the road I look and there runs Bessie, a good old heifer, but she sure is messy. That's how we got the green, green grass at home. Yes, they'll all come for miles, but be sure you dodge the cow piles when you walk across the green, green grass at home. Part, yeah.
Oh, that's good.
The old outhouse is still standing, though the walls are cracked and dry. There's the old oak seat that I used to sit on. Down the lane I'd run, sometimes I'd make it. If I didn't, I'd just have to fake it. That's how we got the green, green grass at home. Yes, they'll all admire the front lawn, but be sure you have your shoes on when you walk across the green, green grass at home. Talk about the VW Boys CDs. I talk from the heart, you know it, because y'all are my friends, and I wouldn't I wouldn't make stuff up about y'all.
Appreciate it.
But honestly, folks, when it comes to the VW Boys CDs, they're not fit to listen to. Now, when we was working this up, I didn't say we had to talk nice about each other, CD. And you know what else is true about them? They're way overpriced. You can buy three of mine for what one of theirs will cost you. Well, which one you want me to do? They've done cut me back to two songs tonight.
Whatever you want to do. How about the butter beans?
All right, but there you talked about how I was a good clawhammer player, and I don't play clawhammer on that one.
All right, well, do what you want to do then. It's your show.
We do. Well, if it's my show, I'd do three songs. You know it? I'd probably do four or five. You said I was going to talk about Teddy Helton, too, and I ain't done that yet. Teddy Helton plays the bass with me down about every week at the Bristol Mall when we do a show down there on Thursday nights. And we usually go out to eat when we get through. And this past Thursday night, we was getting ready to go and we was packing our stuff up to leave. And I said, Teddy, are you going to go out to eat with us tonight? He said, no. He said, I'm going straight home. So I'm going right through that front door. First thing I'm going to do is rip my wife's pantyhose off. And I said, Teddy, what are you getting in such a hurry for? He said, because the elastic in these things is about to cut me in two. So then I said, Teddy, just tell me exactly how long have you been wearing women's pantyhose? He said, ever since my wife found them in the glove compartment of my car. Mountain Dew. Everybody sing on it.